Hi there. I saw this little USB tester and was intrigued by the additional functions it offers for about £15. This is the Ruideng UM34C with Bluetooth. It comes in this little metal box. Opening reveals a single sheet of paper with a QR code and a URL to download instructions and software, and finally the unit itself. USB 3 connector on the front and sockets on the back. The sides have one USB micro port and one USB-C port, a switch to turn Bluetooth on or off, and four little tactile switches, two on each side. It is all open and you can look right through it. This has advantages, for example cooling, but it also means dust, moisture and conductive things like coins, pieces of wire, component leads and so on can get easily in between the boards and cause damage. This probably explains the nice storage box to keep it out of harm's way in a toolbox. Unfortunately, if you follow the QR or URL, you only get a Chinese manual as you see here on the left. However, there are English versions which you can find with a bit of searching. I put a link to the version on the right in the description of this video. Apart of stating the wrong model in the header, it appears to be a direct translation. A quick look at the technical parameters. It measures 4 to 24 volts at 10 millivolt resolution and plus minus 0.2% and one digit accuracy. Current goes from 0 to 4 amps at 1 milliamp resolution and 0.8% plus 3 digit accuracy. Both of these values are really good, if they are true. It does the usual capacity and energy measurements in milliampere hours and watt hours, and maybe a bit pointlessly, there is a temperature measurement. It also promises some unusual stuff such as load impedance and graphing. I have the 34C, and the C stands apparently for communication as it has additional Bluetooth and there's an app available. Unfortunately, only for Android, and it needs to be sideloaded as it's not in the App Store, which is not a good thing. It is fairly easy to open with the four screws on the back as the unit is a sandwich of three boards. The other side opens just as easy, but contains only the display itself and the bulk of the two main USB 3 connectors. Here's a close-up shot of the components on the main board. I have annotated some of the components. The processor is an STM8S005C6. It's that big chip here. A relatively beefy transistor, which I don't know what it does. What looks like a thermistor and acts as a temperature sensor, a Schottky diode, which I suspect is there for reverse voltage protection because I did that accidentally and the UM34C survived, an ultra-low dropout power regulator for 3.3 volts, which can take up to 35 volts as input according to its Chinese datasheet, and an op-amp, which according to its datasheet has a key application as a buffer and amplifier for analog to digital inputs. There's a 0.01 ohm shunt and at the claimed maximum current of 4 amps, this resistor will drop 40 millivolts and dissipate 0.16 watts, which means it will get hot but not excessively. The 40 millivolt may explain the need for an op amp to be able to measure it with a standard analog to digital converter that's integrated in a chip, like the processor here. The heat produced by the shunt, as well as the power regulator driving the display and the backlight, is probably the main reason that the tester is built using this open stack of three boards with free airflow in between. The other is of course money, as this method costs very little. There's a section of four contacts marked VCC, ground, transmit data and receive data, which is where the Bluetooth module connects. Here's the main board again and the bottom layer board, which holds the Bluetooth module. The module is covered by a thin plastic cover that forms the outer layer of the stack. I like how it is completely separate and gets its data and power through the 4-pin connector with spring contact touching the main board when the stack is put together. A very clean and neat design to make the two versions of the UM34 with or without Bluetooth. The Bluetooth module itself is not the latest and greatest design. It uses the BK3231 transceiver, which is implementing the Bluetooth 2.1 standard, but works well for this application. Incidentally, the pin for pairing is 1234. A quick look at the datasheet of the main processor. As there is no separate ADC on the main board, the software must use the internal ADC for measuring voltage and current. It's a 10-bit ADC, and the block diagram shows that there are multiple analog inputs selectable by a multiplexer and an internal voltage reference. The summary on the left says plus minus 1 LSB error, but this is the case for 5 volts. For 3.3 volts, as is used in this application, the typical error is a little higher, as shown in this section here. It depends how fast the clock rate is of the ADC. I suppose in this application they can get away with a lower clock rate, but obviously they must employ tricks like at least 4 to 8 bit oversampling and averaging to boost the ADC's resolution from 10 to 11 or 12 bits, because with a 10-bit ADC alone you can't get the promised 10 millivolt resolution in a range of 24 volts. 24 volts divided by 1024 is 23 millivolt resolution. I guess I better put the 10 millivolt resolution claim into the list of things to verify. But enough of theory, let's see it in action. For showing you the basics, I simply connect the unit to a USB power source. It boots up and reports its version number. The first screen out of 6 possible appears, and you can see on the reflection on the desk that the Bluetooth LED is blinking, showing that it tries to establish a link. Let's ignore Bluetooth for now. By the way, the unit remembers the screen it was on and restores it after power up, so screen 1 is not always the first one to show after the version display. The first screen shows the voltage and the current, which is of course 0. You can see which screen of the 6 screens you are on by the 6 blue dots on the top, with the current one shown larger than the others. The unit can keep capacity and energy values for up to 10 groups. At power up, it shows group 0 and the values are blinking because there's not enough current to start measurement. The 9999.9 ohms indicates that there's an open connection on the output because there's no load. When I connect the load, it shows the current and the capacity and the energy counters start incrementing. The UM34C shows the current and voltage and calculates and displays the equivalent resistance of the load. If I briefly press the upper left switch next to the question mark, I get a help screen explaining roughly what the 4 buttons in the screen do. As a rule, there are short presses and long presses. The short presses are always the same, and the question mark and stylized moon select or deselect help or turn the screen on or off. Short presses on the buttons labeled next and brief simply move to the next or previous screen. So in most cases, only the long presses do something different from those functions, and that is what the help screen tries to show. So we can rotate the screen, for example. This read-only screen shows what the UM34 detects as differential voltage between the data and power lines. This relates to the way how devices used to signal their power availability and demands, and the UM34 detects several proprietary standards, such as Quick Charge 2, and informs about it. With USB 2, this type of power selection with resistors was changed to use digital messages to agree on power demands and availability. In any case, the UM34 works transparently with either method, but can only show the physical signaling, not the digital one, so the utility of this screen is strictly limited to older USB devices. This is the recording screen. The 0.10 amp you see here is the threshold of current that the unit must see before it starts recording capacity and energy values. Recording is a bit misleading. A better word would be accumulation, because the unit does not record individual measurements. After a long press on next, the threshold can be set between 0 to 0.30 or 300 milliamps in 10 milliamp steps by repeated presses of the brief button. Once the threshold is exceeded, the REC indicator turns green, showing that accumulation takes place. If it falls below, it stops. This is the screen allowing a two-step measurement of cable impedance, but what they really mean is DC cable resistance measurement. Basically, you need a constant load on the output of the tester. Then connect the unit first directly to the power supply, in this case a USB bank. It shows the current and voltage drawn from the battery next to the blinking diagram. Then press next to store it. Now for step 2, disconnect the unit from the power and reconnect it via the cable you want to measure. You can use a USB extension like this one, or a micro USB or USB-C cable. The unit comes back on, still on the same screen, with the recorded green values and the yellow diagram blinking. Now press next again to record the yellow values. The unit now shows the cable resistance as 0.292 ohms. Screen 1 is the graphic screen. It shows about the last 20 seconds of measurements, and it looks as if it's updated about twice per second, suddenly faster than once per second. Notice that the y-axis are both autoscaled. When I unplug the load, the current goes to zero, forcing a drastic rescale. After plugging it back in, the scale remains that way until the zero current portion is scrolled out on the left. The last screen is the settings screen. I'm using the defaults except for the top one, which is the timeout for the screen. I changed that to zero to avoid it going blank during videoing. To test the Bluetooth capability, I side installed the app which shows as UM meter. It calls home the load is advertising page and obviously checks for updates. I don't think I want to add Portuguese, but I appreciate the thought. By itself, the app doesn't connect to the UM34C, you have to initiate that. And it helps if you did the pairing beforehand as part of the Bluetooth setup of your phone or tablet. By the way, the app does not support rotating the screen, and even when started in landscape mode, rotates back to portrait. Once connected, it basically provides a copy of what is shown on the display, while at the same time graphing the voltage and current readouts and recording them in the background. The graph doesn't attempt to autoscale, but always shows 0 to 25 volts and 0 to 5 amp as the range on the y-axis. You can directly change the data group for storing capacity and energy values and the values indicated by the sliders. Four buttons are presented as the four circles on the display. The previous rotate and next are doing exactly the same as the physical buttons on the UM34C. The clear data is a function that needs a long press on the UM34C. Since they gave an extra button for clear data, it is no surprise that a long press, for example to start measuring cable resistance, is not recognized. So even with Bluetooth, there are cases where you need to press buttons on the device itself. I guess the main selling point for the UM34 with Bluetooth is that the app can save the recorded data as an Excel spreadsheet. You initiate this by pressing the file button on the top. There's no choice in file name or location. It is always called um34c.xls and stored in the root directory. It doesn't warn you if there's already a file with that name and simply overwrites it with whatever data it received since the last time you pressed the file button. Here's how a recording looks when opened in LibreOffice Calc, which is very similar to Microsoft Excel and also allows similar kinds of graphs. I explain how this recording was done in a moment. From the timestamp, we can see that the data is recorded once per second. This is followed by voltage, current, and the delta voltages on the data lines, and the last entry is the date. Obviously, the time and date are from the tablet or mobile phone, since the UM34C has no real-time clock on board. Voltages and currents are stored as numbers and so are directly usable for calculations and graphs, but time and date entries are stored as text strings and you need to do conversions to process them. I tested the app and the Excel file is only created after you press the file button, which means it must store the data internally in memory or in a temporary file. If we assume that in the app the timestamp is internally stored as a 64-bit long and each of the four recorded values as 32-bit floats, 1 second of data uses just 24 bytes of storage, so an hour worth of data needs about 84K and 12 hours about 1 megabyte. I have tested doing recordings of slightly more than 4 hours with a spreadsheet containing 14,700 rows and there was no problem. While usually making of the spreadsheet is almost instantaneous from pressing the file button, that one took maybe 2 seconds, which is still no issue. What I really like about the app's recording feature is that you don't have to decide in advance to record. It always records, so if you suddenly discover something that you would like to investigate further, you just have to press the file button to keep it. And if you don't want to keep anything, the recording is automatically gone when closing the app. I only wish they would put a timestamp in the file name to prevent accidental overwrite. I just like to quickly show how the app's graphing works, slightly sped up. As I mentioned, it keeps the y-axis scale constant, but keeps changing the time scale on the x-axis, so it works exactly the other way around from the graphing on the UM34 itself. For this test, I connected a relay to a function generator set to produce a 0.1 Hz square wave. When active, the relay connects a 10 ohm resistor to the output of the UM34C, so we have 5 seconds of 0.5 amps followed by 5 seconds of zero current. You can see that this method shows more and more history at the cost of losing detail. Clearly, the developers were thinking of applications like battery charging or discharging, where this way of graphing allows you to see more of the curve. On the other hand, you can always just press the file button and graph the recorded data in the spreadsheet any way you like you saw earlier. So we know that the UM34C works, but how well does it meet its specs? A USB tester is a bit unique in that it gets its own power from the same source it's supposed to measure. So two interesting numbers: how much it loads the USB source with current for its own consumption, and if that USB voltage is dropping, how long can the tester still work and show correct values. Voltage and current test ranges are pretty self-explanatory. We need to look at how well the cable resistance measurement works. Capacity and energy measurement, which is basically current or watts over time. So if we already know the accuracy of the current and volts measurements, this tests the accuracy of the time measurement. The last is a test to check if the current threshold you can set to start or stop accumulation of capacity or energy in the UM34C works as promised. So let's get to it. To test the idle current, I'm driving the UM34C from the power supply on top of the multimeter. The multimeter shows the voltage to the UM34C and I'm using the current display at the power supply to read the current. Although the power supply has its own voltage readout, the multimeter is far more accurate and at low there will be a voltage drop over the leads to the terminal block. As you can see, the idle current, that is the current consumed by the UM34C itself, is relatively high at 27 milliamps. But this is with the screen on default brightness level 4 out of 5 and Bluetooth on as well. Turning the Bluetooth off drops it to about 23 to 24 milliamps. Turning the display off as well turns it down to just 8 milliamps, so really the bulk of the consumption is running the display. Turning Bluetooth on and keeping the display off needs 13 milliamps. For the remaining tests, I'm going to keep Bluetooth off unless I need it for specific reasons. The spec says the lowest measurement voltage is 4 volts. I'm curious how low the voltage can drop before the processor shuts down. Remember, it runs at 3.3 volts via an ultra-low drop voltage regulator. Starting at 4 volts, I'm lowering the input voltage in 10 millivolt steps. At 3.96 volts, the processor shuts down. Let's see when it comes back to life. It needs about 4.2 volts to come back, but once it does, it can apparently tolerate reduction to 4 volts, but with very little margin. To measure voltage accuracy, I'm going to increase the voltage in 500 millivolt steps from 4 volts to 24 volts and record the readout on the UM34C and the multimeter displays for analysis. This is a rather slow process, so I'm showing this accelerated. Besides the voltage readouts, also keep an eye on the temperature on the UM34C display. It is important to have little or no load when comparing voltage readouts in this setup because of the unavoidable voltage drop between where my multimeter is connected and where the chip inside the UM34C measures the voltage. As you can see, I use short and thick cables, but you will notice later at higher currents the drop is still very noticeable. For this reason, I'm running this test without any load. This red line represents the claimed 0.2% accuracy. From 5 volts and above, the UM34C is actually pretty impressively accurate. Those spikes are really caused by just one digit difference, which is still within spec. For the range from 4 to 5 volts, the error is slightly above spec, but still good and fully usable. Did you notice the large temperature increase during the voltage test even without any load? I only noticed that afterwards when watching the recording and decided this warranted further investigation. In this test, I was running the UM34C at 5 volts for almost 4 minutes and the temperature barely moved 2 degrees to 23 degrees. Watch what happens after I increase the voltage to 24 volts. Within a minute, we are above 30 and it keeps going up. About 15 minutes into the test, we are at 39 degrees and I turn the display off. After 5 minutes with the display off, the temperature had dropped from 39 degrees to 31 degrees but is immediately on the increase again. The heat comes from the 3.3 volt power regulator. With a load of approximately 23 milliamps for processor and display, the regulator has to drop the difference between 3.3 volt and the actual input, 5 volts, and convert it to heat. At 5 volts, that's just 39 milliwatts. But at 24 volts, it's almost half a watt. While it is in contact with a PCB, this isn't much of a heatsink and also heats all the components in close proximity, including the temperature sensor, the capacitor, and of course the processor itself. This means, in the interest of longevity of the UM34C, one should not keep the screen permanently on when the voltage is more than a couple of volts above 5. So displaying the temperature on the display is a useful feature after all. Now for the claim of the 10 millivolt resolution. For this, I needed a method that allows me to change the voltage in less than 10 millivolt increments. My power supplies only do 10 millivolt steps, and so I came up with this setup. It produces only a very narrow variable range of 200 millivolt, centered around 9.7 volts, but it allows really fine control. The combination of 10 ohms in parallel with a variable resistance of 68 ohms produces a total variable resistor from 0 to 8.7 ohms that is no longer linear. As you can see, after about one third of the turn range of the variable resistor, the the curve of the voltage drop per degree of turn becomes so flat that it's easily allowing adjustments in single millivolts. You can see that the UM34C has no problem to follow the multimeter closely. Both display the voltage with 10 millivolt resolution. So yes, the 10 millivolt resolution claim is confirmed. To verify the current, I decided to do 5 passes for the most commonly used voltages, namely 5 volts, 9 volts, 15 volts, 20 volts and 24 volts, and for each of these voltage settings, run the current from 200 milliamps in 200 milliamp steps up to the maximum. I'm using my electronic load for this, which I discussed in an earlier video linked into the description below. This is a somewhat accelerated video footage of the 5 volt pass. The passes for the other voltages are exactly the same, and I decided not to include the video. Nice, it can measure almost 4.1 amp before showing overload. The result may look a little bit confusing, but it's really similar to the voltage test earlier, except there are 5 lines here, one for each test voltage. The y-axis shows the error in percent against the comparison BM235 multimeter, and the x-axis shows the current. The curves are so jittery because of the single-digit errors. The stated accuracy is 0.8% plus 3 digits, and the UM34C meets this easily. In fact, it isn't quite that easy. In this test series, the accuracy of the comparison instrument, a BM235, was barely better than the UM34C. Here's the situation for the 5 volt 1 ampere test step. The BM235 was reading 1.001, while the UM34C was reading 0.999. Now, based on the accuracy of the BM235, the worst case, the true current could have been anywhere between 0.990 and 1.011 amps, which is the size of the blue bar. Similar for the UM34C, in the worst case, any value between 0.998 amps and 1.009 amps could have caused the displayed number we have seen. If we assume that the BM235 is in spec, then really we can only say with certainty that the UM34C is out of spec if the two uncertainty bars do not overlap at least somehow. It is crucial to note that the reverse is not true. Even if they overlap, the UM34C could still be way out of spec. The problem is that we have no way of knowing where in the blue bar the true value lies. It may be so far to the non-overlapping side that while the BM235 is still in spec, the UM34C may be out of spec, even though the bars do overlap. I've calculated the bars for all 90 tests and they overlap in all cases. Better still, they overlap almost perfectly, which means that we can be confident that the UM34C current measurements are in spec and almost match the BM235. By the way, the only reason that we did not have to go through all this for the voltage test is that the multimeter used for comparison is way more accurate than the UM34C. So in case the blue uncertainty bar was so tiny that we can treat it as a true value. Sadly, the current measurement range of this old bench multimeter is only good for 2 amps, which is why I had to switch to the BM235. Moving on to cable resistance. The principle is shown here. It's a two-step process, as we know, and the cable to be measured has to be inserted between the power source and the UM34C, and not between the UM34C and the load. For connecting the test cable in step 2, you don't need to use the same standard USB-A connector of step 1, but you can use a micro USB or USB-C socket on the UM34C instead. The measurement principle is very simple. Step 1 establishes a baseline of voltage and current. Then you remove its direct connection to power and replace it with your test cable. The UM34C will turn off during this process, but it has remembered the baseline and is ready for step 2 when the power is re-established. The cable resistance will cause a voltage drop, which the UM34C measures, and using the current value, it can simply calculate the equivalent cable resistance using Ohm's law. The accuracy depends on that neither the voltage from the power source nor the load current changes between the two steps. Unfortunately, in practice, this is very difficult to achieve, and so the results may be quite inaccurate. For this test, I'm using a power supply to feed the UM34C with about 5 volts. There's a 10 ohm load resistor, but because of the test leads, the load is in fact 10.6 ohms as measured by the UM34C. Later, I will swap this 1 ohm resistor into the supply line to simulate a cable. I'm going to perform step 1 by a long press of next, and the UM34C records the present values. I'm now putting the 1 ohm resistor into the supply. And now perform step 2. The UM34C shows the cable resistance as 1.14 ohm, but notice that the step 1 current of 471 milliamp is very different from step 2 with 423 milliamp. For resistors as loads, this is unavoidable, but let's try the same test again with some other loads instead of power resistor on a heatsink. I'm doing the same test but with a tablet connected instead of a resistor. Step 1 done, time to put the 1 ohm resistor in. And perform step 2. Wow, now the same cable is just 0.434 ohms. How did that happen? Hold on for just one more test, but notice how different the currents in the two steps were. 435 milliamps in step 1 and just 117 in step 2. Same test again, but this time I'm using my electronic load set to constant current 500 milliamp. Step 1. Disconnect and insert the same 1 ohm resistor as before. The electronic load has turned itself off as well when the power was removed. Step 2, I need to turn the electronic load back on. Now the resistor is 1.204 ohms. This table here shows the measurements and the results. This row shows the resistance values displayed by the UM34C. The only correct one is the last one that was done with the electronic load. It is actually quite easy to figure out how the UM34C gets its wrong results. It calculates the voltage drop between the two steps and then divides it by the average current. That is, it adds step 1 and step 2 currents together and divides the result by 2 to get the average current. Using this method, I produce the displayed values in this row, and they match the values produced by the UM34C perfectly. It turns out it could have been far better to use the current from step 2 directly instead of averaging, because in this row it shows the results are not as far out as with the method they use. I don't know why they didn't use that simpler method. In any case, the only true accurate value can be obtained if the current doesn't change between the steps, which means you need an electronic load. If you use a resistor, it's inevitable that the results are wrong. with the algorithm chosen by the UM34C developers. Here's why. This diagram represents step 1. We measure 5 volts and 500 milliamps flows through the 10 ohm load. I'm ignoring all kinds of influences such as resistance of leads, internal resistance of the power supply and the inside the UM34C, and tolerances of the resistors for this case. Now if we add an additional 1 ohm resistor and we have a classic voltage divider. Because the total resistance is now 11 ohms, the current drops to 454 milliamps. And we can calculate that the voltage across the 10 ohm resistors is of course 5.54 volts, while the 1 ohm resistor drops the remaining 0.454 volts. Together, they add up of course to 5 volts. Using the UM34C method, the resistance of the 1 ohm resistor will be calculated as 0.95 ohms based on the average current, but if we had used the step 2 current, it would have come out as 1 ohm, of course. So if you know you have a resistor as a load, you could ignore the results showing by the UM34C and do the calculation yourself based on the voltages and step 2 current as shown on the UM34C display. But in my experience, apart from cup warmers, maybe you won't find any devices with a USB plug that represent true resistors. I tested a few here, and as you can see, they are all not flat horizontal lines as a true resistor would be, namely always having the same resistance value regardless of the voltage. The devices I tested changed the resistance and current significantly depending on the voltage applied to them. And that voltage will change because of the drop caused by the insertion of the cable in step 2. It's actually worse because pretty much all devices with internal batteries change their resistance constantly, even with the same voltage applied, for example when the battery is filling up and the charge current drops. Because these devices invalidate the principle on which the two-step resistance measurement relies, the results cannot be trusted. To test the capacity and energy measurement, I reset the values and then use the timer to run 1 amp of current at 5 volts for 30 minutes. The 5 volts drop to 4.87 because of the resistance in the leads to the UM34C. Theoretically, 1 amp for 0.5 hours should result in 500 milliampere hours of capacity. Similar, 4.87 volts at 1 amp equals to 4.87 watts, so in half an hour we should see 2.435 watt hours. The actuals are very close. 498 milliampere hours and 2429 milliwatt hours. The reason for slight errors is of course inaccuracy of my timing and that the UM34C has to calculate the current values for capacity and energy at every measurement cycle and then add these very tiny increments to the previous results. Given these constraints, the UM34C is giving a reasonably accurate result. I had to do quite a bit of experimentation until I started to understand how the recording threshold really works and when you may want to use it. I think the only case is to measure the capacity or energy needed to charge a battery but ignore the trickle charge phase after the full capacity has been reached. Let me demonstrate. Assuming we are still in the full charging part of the battery, the UM34C is recording capacity and energy on screen 1 and, because the charge current is more than a threshold, it's also updating screen 3. As you can see, the values are updating. REC is on and the recording time is incrementing. The threshold is set to 100 milliamps. I'm now slowly decrementing the current below the threshold of 100 milliamps. This simulates the battery now going into trickle charge. On screen 3, the values of 139 milliampere hours and 698 milliwatt hours are now frozen and the REC indicator is off. These values would represent what capacity and energy was used to fully charge the battery in 4 minutes and 41 seconds. Back on screen 1, the capacity and energies are still increasing, even though we are well below the threshold. In the charging a battery scenario, these values now represent the total capacity and energy used and include the continuous trickle charge current. So let's wait for a moment to make sure a bit of extra charge accumulates on screen 1. About 4.5 minutes of trickle charge have passed, and screen 1 now shows capacity and energy values of 145 milliampere hours and 729 milliwatt hours. While over at screen 3, we still see the accumulated main charge of the battery and the time it took. Watch what happens if for some reason the charge current suddenly increases again above the threshold as I'm simulating here. The values from screen 1 are simply copied over. This is wrong, because these values include all the trickle charge as well, and were recorded when the current was below the threshold. The recording time is also wrong, or at least not consistent, because it does not include the additional 4.5 minutes we sat watching the trickle charge, and which are now part of the shown capacity and energy. So at best you could say the time shows how long the current was over the threshold, but it has nothing to do with the values shown directly above it. My advice is to set recording threshold to 0 and not use this feature at all. So finally, where are we with the UM34C? The idle current is a little bit on the high side if the display is on, and you need to be aware of the heat build up if you're using voltages above 10 volts and the display is on. It's better to keep the display on automatic off or turn it off yourself if you use voltages above 10 volts, or keep an eye on the temperature build up. The dropout voltage of 3.96 volt is very tight, very close to the 4 volts, and it could cause you a problem if you have, for example, if you measure resistance using the two-step process and your cable is really bad, it could be that your voltage drops below the 3.96 volts and the UM34C will simply not work. The voltage range is generally very good, and from 5 volts to 25 volts it is very accurate. From 4 to 5 volts it's not quite meeting its spec, but it's still very usable. The current range, as far as I can measure it, meets its spec or is even better than the spec. The USB power negotiation display is only usable for pre-USB 2 devices that use the old analog signaling based on resistors, and all the newer devices that do digital power messaging, you don't know what they negotiate, but the UM34C will in any case show what current and voltages are used on the connection, so that's not really that much of a problem. The cable resistance measurement depends. If you use constant current as a load, it works very well. That's an electronic load. If you use a constant resistance, meaning a true resistor, you get inaccurate results, but they can be easily fixed using a calculator and just using the values displayed on the UM34C, and you use the current from step 2 instead of the average, you get good results. If you use any other load, then you generally get unusable results. The capacity and energy measurement accuracy is reasonable, and the recording threshold for this works, but its use is very limited. If the current rises, you have seen that, above the threshold, it gets all messed up and they are no longer correct. So my recommendation is not to use that and just keep the threshold to zero. The app itself, I'm not happy that it phones home and it's not in the App Store and it's only available on Android. There is apparently an open source Linux version which I need to dig out and try out. That would be a great improvement, at least for me, because I'm using Linux. The recording and saving as an Excel spreadsheet works really well, so that's the saving grace, and it's the only reason why I would recommend using the Bluetooth version, because that is so much so usable, because it always records and you can just save when you need it. The only problem with that is it overrides, or recordings override each other with no warning. So it would be great if they had file names that change. In summary, the UM34C does the basic job of measuring voltage and current on a USB bus really well, as long as you don't have to drop below 4 volts, and I definitely recommend it for that purpose. The results are accurate, the display is easy to read, and if you have the Bluetooth version and the app, the spreadsheet recording capability can be really very useful. Capacity and energy measurements work well as long as you don't use the threshold. Don't buy it for the cable impedance facility unless you have a suitable load. I hope you found this review useful. If you do, give it a thumbs up. Thanks for watching.